If you feel like hops right now, don't worry, we'll get through in a very short time. And don't expect to, just to set the expectations right. This is just a fun session, sort of. This, don't expect to learn too much and become the next best data scientist after you do this session. So, let's get started. Does anyone know who this person is? I don't know who this is. Oh, okay, cool. So, I've selected the right picture. So this is Galileo Galilei, who is known also as the father of modern science, named as the father of modern science by Albert Einstein himself, or even by Stephen Hawking and many others. And there's a small interesting story about Galileo. How many of you know what this is? Can you see what it is clearly at the back?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know what it is? Okay, so this is a chandelier which is hung up in the Pisa Cathedral. And as Vincenzo Viviani, Galileo's biographer, he has noted that in 1582, when Galileo was around 17 or 18 years old, he was sitting in this Pisa Cathedral and he was watching this chandelier. Every time a whiff of breeze came in, the chandelier would swing just a little bit. Okay? And this intrigued Galileo. He wanted to know what was the period of oscillation of that chandelier. Okay? But he did not have a clock at that moment. So he decided to use his own heartbeat to measure how much time it took to swing. And in the process of observations, he noted down, irrespective of how strong the breeze was, every time the period of oscillation was the same. So even if the chandelier would get displaced by this much, or it would get displaced by this much, the period of oscillation was remaining the same. This intrigued him, and then he started his studies with simple pendulums, and he did a lot of research on that. And only in about 1642 sometime, or maybe just before that, he got this idea of using this property. He called this isochronism, the property of taking the same amount of time to complete an oscillation, irrespective of certain factors. Okay. So, in around 1642, it struck him that he could use this property to create a clock. Okay? And then he gave out the basic design. But at that point, Galileo had already turned 9 and he was in house arrest for having done contempt of the church and whatnot. Maybe you know the story. But so that design that he gave out, it was not a work in a design. Idea was picked up by Christian Huygens and he made world's first pendulum clock. Okay? So he used this idea from Galileo that the period of the pendulum remains same irrespective of the initial amplitude, as well as it remains same even if you change the mass that you suspect. Okay? Now, these clocks, obviously, he created in 1656. Until 1930s, when the quartz clocks, quartz watches became popular, like throughout the 18th and 19th century, these clocks were arranged and they powered the industrial revolution in some sense, because they were used for timekeeping, for plan-made schedules, in factories, at railroad stations, which is made everywhere this was popular. But before we were come up with this, Christian Huygens was faced with one small challenge. Okay? He had to solve this differential equation to come up with the relationship between the length of the pendulum and the time it definitely having an effect on the mean. Alright, so Christian, I think, was looking at this equation and is thinking about how we go about solving this, what assumptions can I make, what simplifications can I make. And at that point, you saw my time machine earlier, right? I used my time machine, my cabinet box, and I transported myself back in time. And I went and told Christian, I guess, don't worry, I come from the generation of data scientists. Just give me your data. I'll do the analysis. I'll find out the relationship. That's what we do day in and day out. We are the data scientists. Alright, says Christian. And he gives me this data. And I say, okay, like any good data scientist, what's the first thing that you do? Look at the visuals. This is the plot. After looking at this plot, what's the first instinct? Not like this relationship is just simple linear, right? And I'm thinking at the back of my mind, what is this Christian Huygens guy really famous for? What did he really do? It's just a simple straight line. I can just do simple linear regression. And I can get done with it. Alright, so let's do it. Let's do the analysis ourselves. Okay, you cannot see the screen, but you do get my place. What's there? Actually, you don't have, but I'll just tell you what I'm doing here. I'm having this very data in CSV file, simple CSV. Can you see this? Yes. So on the left, I have the first thing to the CSV is the length of the pendulum, and then there's a period for 20 oscillations. Why do we take 20 oscillations? Why not just one oscillation and be done with it? Reaction time is where the error can be even, right? I can see that the pendulum is here, but it may not be here. I may be getting a little slow. I may have reaction time with my clocks. So what I do is, I count 20 oscillations here. It's not getting turned on. No pun intended.
Predict what the outcome should be as close to the real process as possible.
set. Okay. Alright, so let's run the linear model. What do we get? This is the line, and at this moment I am thinking like, okay, Mr. Christian, this is it. We're done. Christian, I guess, he's looking at all what I'm doing, and this is smiling to indicate me, and I don't realize how. He just puts me in one question. Okay, alright. That's all good. Now, what is the length of the period for 1 second? After all, I want to make a clock, right? I need pendulum and period equal to 1 second. I say, that's simple, this. You just have to draw a horizontal line where the intercept is equal to 20 because you are taking data for 20 oscillations, and we should be the relevant intercept, the red line. That's your point. Alright. And Christian sees this. Let's expand this problem. Christian sees this. And he says, okay, do you just want to draw the y axis once for me? I said, yeah, why not? Brilliant. And this is the point I realized why he was trying to make it. The intersection is behind 0. My predicted length is negative. Now, at least after 300 or 400 years later, we realize that it is possible to make a pendulum that gives 1 second beat. Right? So, definitely, I have a thought on something. Okay? At this moment, Mr. Atkins is. And you say, like every software developer, we say, that was just beta. We were expecting bugs. And you give me one more chance, and I'll probably do something else. So I'm now thinking, what did I miss? Should I hard at the pass? But then, no. Galileo did a lot of research. Galileo was a smart man. Should I trust him? I say, okay, let me do something else. Can you think of what you can do here? Anyone? Yeah? Or I'll just take higher order terms of length, maybe n square, and try to analyze what's the relationship of the pendulum with n square or n cube or something like that. Okay? So let's do that. So it's essentially the same thing. This line here, line number 4. I'm taking that square and I'll do the whole exercise again. And this time it's gotten worse. Okay, the intersection is even half the time, which means I need a pendulum with more negative length, which I don't know how. What am I missing? What should we really do? Sorry? Yeah, this line is not fitting the data correctly. I mean, as it is, the fit is probably worse than compared to what it was earlier. This could be one conclusion. Can I do something else? Can I do something else with this? Can I do something else with the analysis that I'm doing? Sorry? Square? 2? Okay. 1 billion charted audience. We are actually going to take the square root of the observed length and let's see what happens. Oh, we've got an intersection on the positive side. Okay, brilliant. Now we can go and digest it. Look, this is the approximate length 0.5, somewhere around 0.5. We can be accurate about it, but it's around 0.5. So this is the square root of the length. To get the actual length, just need to square it up. That will be close to 0.25. And 25 centimeters, that's the length approximately where you'll get the 1 second period. You can go and check in your class, you'll probably have a 25 centimeter long pendulum. Okay? But since it is, that's okay. Give me a more general demonstration. And I say, okay, let's hang the pendulum here. And if I have trust in the logic that I have developed, we measure the period of the pendulum. And then I come up with a length. You decide the length of the pendulum, what it should be. And we'll see if I can predict the length. This is the world's best friend. Took me 2 hours to make. Very thin, very thin. So this is an arbitrary length. Does is anyone willing to change it? Just to make sure that I'm not using a pre-measured length. Is that, does anyone want to change it? You're free to do that. Come over. Take this line of length. Minus of So 1.29, that this is the square root. So what should we do? Square. Okay. 1.664. But there's one thing we need to be honest about. There is going to be some measurement inaccuracy, because the kind of devices that we're going to use to measure the length of the pendulum, that means the ladder, so is just a simple measuring tape. And we say that the error is likely to be close to, let's say, plus minus 5 centimeters, likely to be less than 2 centimeters. But we'll say it's 5 centimeters and less than 8. We will need the ladder to take it down again. Sorry, this is going to take slightly more time.
Any questions for Vishal?
Yeah.
So, you were showing us that the end of the day, it looks like it's green.
Yes.
And you're talking about the experiment that was related to the length of the day, and then you can get a larger length of what you're doing.
Yes.
So, you need to talk about the question about the single analysis of the day. What are the questions about what you're doing here, or how you're doing it? How you're doing it?
A little bit, yes. This sometimes what happens is often we get carried away by the powerful techniques that we have. And these days we have not relied on these computational techniques or numerical techniques per se, rather than going the analytical way. So if you look at that differential equation, it is possible to solve that differential equation by making an assumption that theta is small. For small theta, you will have to sin theta by theta approaching equal to 1. Okay? So if you substitute that, you get the equation of simple harmonic motion, when you get from spring, outer adjustment in spring. Okay? So that equation is easy to solve, and then you will come up with a formula for period. That will be E is approximately equal to 2 pi times square root of L by G. Okay? So that's the problem of here that you can do by solving it analytically. So here it is very obvious that it is proportional to the square root. 2 pi by root G is your constant. So if you see, if you just divide this 40.18 by 20, that's the slope, right? That's the proportionality constant. It should turn out close to 2 pi by root. Again, the intercept value, it's a very small value. If you look at this value, you can probably think, is it because of my errors in my observation? zero in the real analytical relationship that exists. Okay, so these are things. Pay attention to the analytical side as well, which is usually a little underrated these days. Earlier on, that was the only go-to method because numerical techniques and computational power wasn't available. Yet one more question. Given the data, the equation of the curve is this. You have period for 20 oscillations, right? Period for 20 oscillations.
Is it good? Thousands of points. That's what I want. I want to know what it is. That's what I want.
Yes, yes. That is what we have done.
That I can understand.
Okay, so let's try to write the equation for period and the length. Okay, or actually, let's just write it here. What we have is this thing visible to everyone?
That's what
that's Yes. Good. There was one question there.
Yeah. So, when you wrote that formula, for the time interval, which was constant from the so, if we use that formula, we could think deterministic image. And when we are using regression, if you add an error, it will be probabilistic. That is the power of data science, that you don't have to worry about the actual formula, but if you utilize, for example, in this case, regression analysis, adding an error term, it will more or less generalize or provide you an answer despite those if you have a fixed formula for it. So you don't have to worry about what knowing the formula is.
Right, and it also highlights the reason why I started with length and length square was it also highlights typical caveats. Like if you are not looking at other statistics, other important figures like R-square, how good the fit is, or does the data actually not correlated but still in the straight line? Okay, so these are the factors which why should tend to overlook, which is what I want to highlight. So you can't just depend on the analysis to give you perfect result. You have to have some sort of conclusion, some sort of judgment. When you are using,
this is more complicated, but when we saw that differential equation, invariably somewhere linear equation to identify discrete line ends up doing the partial derivative to identify your study cost function is less.
I'll contradict that. It uses partial derivatives to find out what's the minima of the function of the error function, right? So you write a cost function which is associated. So this will go beyond the scope. How are we doing the time?
Well, sort of.
And done?
Yeah.
We'll meet online and I can do the derivation of how it actually does using partial derivatives, how it finds out the minima. Okay? Alright, so that's about it.